Good morning. How's everybody this morning? If I could get you all to stand, get ready to worship the Lord on this beautiful morning. Thank you, Father. Let's pray. Father, we just come before you and we just worship you, God. We thank you for your blessing that's on this day. Lord, this is a day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in this day, Father. We just thank you, Lord, and we want to make your praise glorious, like Pastor Mike always says, Lord. So, Father, we just thank you that we can come before you. We can come in, we can enter your gates with thanksgiving and your courts with praise, Lord. Thank you, Father. We worship you, Lord. We bless your holy name, Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
All right.
Let's clap. One, two, three. Hey!
Death is defeat. the faith, never enough. Then you came along,
yes you did,
and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than
just have my hopes, my dreams, my world. With joy I lay it down, with joy I cast my crowns. Jesus, have it all. To you I bring my praise, my lips, my song. A living sacrifice as one reborn. Your life is now my own, your will is what I want. Jesus, have it all. Oh, Jesus, have it all. Jesus, have it all. To you belongs the glory, the praise of all.
Have it all. Mercyful, wonderful majesty.
You're so worthy, God. We do this morning, we crown you, God. It's like that old song, you're worthy of it all. You're so worthy, God. We worship you. We adore you. We lift your name on high. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. Worthy are you, God. You're so worthy, Lord, that you endured the cross. We worship you.
Yes, Lord. Let's say that together. Say, you are worthy, O God. How many of you know that Jesus is Lord? Amen. Praise God. You may be seated. Thank you so much there, worship team. That was absolutely beautiful. Wow, just to give the praises of the Lord like that. Well, many of you we know have been to a couple of days of meetings this last week. Ended actually Saturday at supper time. That was with a prophetic ministry that we've known actually for some time by the name of Mark DuPont. And I'm so glad that Transform Central was very well represented. We were one of the participating churches, and as well as Westwood Community Church and the Zion Fellowship and a number of parachurch ministries. How many of you were actually at that conference for either a bit of it or can I just see your hands? Just lift your hands. Praise the Lord. All right. Yeah, we had such a great, great response. And I just want to say thank you for taking the time out. You know, as you know, this is our spring break, and we probably got lots of parents out there vacationing somewhere, you know, near a beach or a body of water or whatever. And so you might be watching with this live stream. And so we just want to welcome our live stream audience. If you're listening here from wherever you are, then we just welcome you here to the service. We're going to be participating in communion right now. And so if you wouldn't mind getting your communion elements ready, as we're doing here. And as we celebrate the communion, you know what? The song there that Rena had picked out was basically a sermon. That was literally the sermon, that last song. You know, we crown you. And it talking about this resurrection season that we're in right now, where you'll probably hear more of it the upcoming Sunday here, where, you know, Jesus, there's a reason we worship him the way we did. Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him would not perish, but it would have everlasting life. And we've taken that very personal. And that's why we become born again Christians. The Bible says that you must be born again. And that is a transaction that takes place whether you're old or young. The Bible says, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord, they shall be saved. And so we are just so excited about the harvest that's been prophesied. You know, and there's going to be more and more people, family members coming to the Lord. How many are believing for prodigals to come home? Yeah. I think we all have some, you know, right? We've all got prodigal sons, daughters, grandchildren, you know, prodigal brothers and sisters or uncles and aunts or even mothers and fathers. And we just keep on trusting the Lord that there will be a breakthrough that will come on the inside of their life. Thank you so much. It's great. I see Eli and Marty Miller. Would you be okay to stand up, Eli and Marty Miller? Bless your heart. God bless you, Eli and Marty. Hallelujah. They are amazing spiritual mentors to Pastor Mike and Katharina and Char and myself. And they'll be doing actually a marriage conference. We're not going to give you details today about it because there's still some script that needs to be written on it. But they're some of the best of the best of the best. And we're so delighted. And recently he had a bit of a setback, but because Eli is Eli, he keeps on moving forward and the clock keeps on ticking. Amen. Praise the Lord. So just really excited to have them in the house. And if you're here also as a guest, first time visitor, we welcome you here to Transform this morning. A couple of announcements while they're still prepping for the communion here. We have the early morning Zoom prayer Monday morning, all the way through to Saturday, 6 o'clock in the morning. And then at 7, we have a five-minute break there, concluding with communion. And if you want to be a part of that, just call the office. It's open Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday from 8 o'clock to 12 o'clock. And we like to have as many people on the prayer. Sometimes we get 3 or 4, sometimes 15 or 16. It really doesn't matter. The Bible says where 2 or 3 are gathered together in my name, he is in the midst of us. And so we really rejoice that we've had this this ongoing prayer for about 4+ years now. And we're excited about it. Then the Tuesday night, we have a fired up group of young adults that meet at 7. And the Friends to Friends meet just before that. And then we have a Friday night group that's called the Tweens Group. And that is led by Justin and Nershan Clausen. I think they got some of the young adults happening there. And I'm excited about that, you know, that they can graduate. We had a young little lady, Kaya Wilming, just aged out of our children's church. And so we got her a gift card, and that's kind of the last time we're going to see her in children's church. But then she can go zip right into the tweens class, right? And then after the tweens class, they can go to the young adults class. And after the young adults class, they can go to the old adults class or whatever it is. You know, right up to age 94, like Sister Gerda. You know, we've got something for you. We've got life groups meeting throughout the week there too. We're really celebrating not just the public, but also the Bible says they met from house to house, and they met in the public temple as well. And so we believe in not only a Saturday or a Sunday worship service, public service like this, but we also believe that it's important that we would have smaller gatherings. That's where there's a lot more intimacy and relationship and dialogue. Here you don't really get to talk too much, right? You see the back of everybody's head. Nothing wrong with that. But there's just something different about the dynamic of a small home group, okay? We got Vicky Powell that's going to be leading us in April on some meetings, but I don't want to just share that just yet because that's part of our message here this morning. But, you know, we just are encouraged again by so much participation that has been taking place here. How many of you know that God has not called Christianity a spectator sport? We're all called to participate. Just turn to your neighbor and say he's talking about you right now, okay? This is personal Christianity 101, where we all get to participate in that. And I also want to just acknowledge and welcome that I don't think I did this yet, Paul and Mariah, but they're back from their honeymoon. Paul and Mariah are back from their honeymoon. And they're literally newlyweds. Praise the Lord. It's great to have you guys back. Thank you so much for your participation also on the weekend there with the conferences we had. Okay, I'm going to call Pastor Mike to come forward here, and we're going to celebrate in the communion. If you got served in the balcony, could you just wave at us? Okay, praise the Lord. And as I mentioned again, Rena, what an appropriate worship list that you had there, because that last song is so powerful there by Jeremy Riddle. And it basically talks about what Jesus did in the crucifixion and on the cross. And you know what? We are of a belief here, Transform Central, that not only does God forgive us of our sins, but he heals us of all of our diseases. And so let's take this wafer in our hand, and we're going to pray a prayer. Heavenly Father, this morning we come to you, and we just want to say thank you. Thank you for sending your son, Jesus. Mm-hmm. Lord, this is just real life. Lord God, and the plan of salvation that you had in your heart when you sent your one and only son, the best gift that heaven had to give to earth was your son, Jesus.
Thank you.
And the life that you lived, Jesus, on this earth, Lord God, ministering to the needs of people around you. Lord, fallen and lost humanity that were looking for a redeemer, looking for a savior, looking for a king. And they found that, but much more. But the surprise was such a surprise to especially the 12 disciples when they expected you to stay a lot longer. And Lord, that you would be here to rule over the Romans and to squander anything and everything that the enemy had brought on this earth. But Father, you had a different plan. You sent your son Jesus to the cross to die for our sins. And Lord God, as many of us have seen movies like this, that Lord, those stripes that they put upon your back, Lord, they were horrible, horrific. And yet, Lord, according to Isaiah's prophecy, you said, by his wounds, by his stripes, we were healed. Mm-hmm. So we receive this healing today for our spirit, soul, and body. In Jesus' name, let's partake together.
Thank you, Lord, that you also shed your blood for us. And that through your blood we have remission of sins.
That's right.
Lord, we make lots of mistakes. Lord, we allow wrong thoughts in our heads. Sometimes we look at things we shouldn't, Lord. Sometimes we listen to things we shouldn't, Lord. Lord, your word says that if you counted our sins against us, not one of us could stand.
That's right.
Thank you for your blood that not only forgives our sin, but it removes the legal right for the enemy to oppress and harass and afflict us, Lord.
That's right.
So we receive not only healing, but deliverance through your shed blood this morning. Let's drink together. Thank you, Lord. Pastor Ken, Jesus loves me more because I got double portion. I just have to say. Because they served me there and then you called me up here. I didn't know you were going to do that. So,
okay.
Or maybe it's just that I'm more needy than you are.
Yeah.
I think that's what it is, right?
I think the latter is true. Stay up here if you wouldn't mind. Before the children go downstairs, we would like to show you a video. And then Pastor Mike's going to share a little bit about the men's retreat that we've got that's coming up. But there is a, as you know, again, if this is your first time here or you've been newer to the fellowship here, we had this project that was on our heart there for Pastor Keith and Coral Abraham, which served a part of this house here in leadership for about 8 years from South Africa. And he had a terrible, terrible accident a number of years ago, which he's now in a confined to a wheelchair. And anyhow, the Lord placed it upon the leadership that we would raise some funds from the body in order to fix their fence. Their fence was completely run down, and you know, it was just a real eyesore and other things that needed to be manicured as well, which we're in the process of doing. Anyway, we've done this for 2 weeks now. We said we would need about $11,000 in order to complete the task, and had some people, I guess it was last weekend, wasn't it, Pastor Mike, that went out there and helped serve in a practical way to kind of level the place. And then A&G Fencing was responsible for putting the fence together. And they're just about at a completed stage. But we're really happy to report that over $11,000 came in.
Hallelujah.
And just two Sundays. And so please stop giving toward this project because enough has come in. In fact, so much more has come in that we're going to be looking as a leadership to perhaps put in some raised flower beds or garden beds there for Sister Coral, Pastor Keith's wife, and still want to do some work there in the backyard. But I'm overwhelmed, Pastor Mike, at how generous the people have been. But we got a little video that we'd like to throw up on the screen here, just kind of concerning, you know, the development of the project, because it's basically your dollars and cents, you guys, that you put toward this. And again, kudos to you. We just want to say thank you so much for your generosity. Let's see if we can, Nick's got this video up.
This is the before. see those good old Dutch boys in there just working away.
Amen. So again, I think it was, I don't even know what the amount was. Was it close to 12,000, Pastor
Mike? I think a little over 12,000 came in, so praise the Lord. You guys are generous givers.
Yeah, so we have a little bit more to do. And actually, I think Sister Coral, that's Keith's wife, is down in Texas right now to visit some of her family. So when she comes back, she's going to see a completed project. So again, we're just ever so thankful to the contributions of the body of Christ here. Kids can go downstairs now with their staff, their volunteers with Pastor Justin. And Pastor Mike, what's happening with this retreat in Camp Luther in Mission?
Yeah, so there's a guys' one-day retreat together with the men from Church of Zion. And that's going to be happening at Camp Luther, which is out there on Hatsik Lake in Mission. And it's $165, but that covers your accommodation and three good meals on Saturday. Talking with Pastor Caleb and those guys last night, they said they've got 40 guys registered. I know a bunch are from here, from TC, but today's the last day. If you want to get in on that, if you want to register and come out, we're going to have an awesome time of connecting as men, fellowship, prayer, maybe some games. I think they have a ping pong table. It could get carnal. No, just kidding, just kidding, just kidding. I've been sanctified. but yeah, that'll be so much fun out there on the lake. Who knows, we'll pray and believe God will give us some decent weather too. So if you are interested in going to that, please come and see me after the service, and I'll make sure you get the registration link. You don't have to pay up front. You just need to put your name in and your email address, and you're registered, and today's the last day. So.
Right on. Okay, praise the Lord.
One other thing I want to mention. Yeah. This past week on Tuesday, we had a precious family from a persecuted country. That's as much as I'm going to say. But they came and they shared their story with us, which was absolutely amazing. We normally have 30 to 40 that'll come out on a young adult night. We had well over 100. And as they were sharing, I just felt the Holy Spirit say, because I talked with Pastor Ken and said, well, we want to sow into them. And so we'd put aside a little bit. But I felt the Lord say, no, you must give those that are here opportunity to sow into this, because it's such amazing soil. I just want to tell you details, but I can't, sorry. But anyway, we gave an opportunity for people to give. $3,000 came in. Out of like 100 young adults, and some young at heart. There was some older ones, the young at heart. But it's so amazing. They are just overwhelmed. And they really have nothing, because they lost everything and left everything, and they're here by faith. And our young adults raised $3,000 for them. Praise God.
Beautiful. And maybe Katerina needs to make this announcement concerning April 27th. If you could just come, Katerina. And this is for the ladies only. We had some for the men only at Camp Luther. Now, this is actually for the ladies only, with the exception of one guest speaker.
That's right. We have one special male, which will be our speaker. His name happens to be Adam. And ladies, April 27th, come on out. We will have one day morning from, I believe it's 10:30 to 1:30. I don't know if we have a graphic for that, but maybe we can put it up later. Anyway, you will be blessed. Vivian is very, very creative. She's heading it up. And she's creating a garden of the Lord. And it's going to be like these beautiful, huge, 3-foot-high papier-mâché flowers, roses, daisies. And you're going to be able to be ministered to. There's a little bit of food and an amazing speaker that we have. So there it is, King's Garden. That's what we'll be calling it. Come on out. So it's free. And we will be just having you register through, what is it called?
Eventbrite.
Just so we know how many are coming out. Anyway, thank you.
Great. Okay, thank you so much. So to conclude, we'll get ready for the morning tithes and offerings. And if you could bring the offering buckets up here, Johannes. And again, you know, thank you for the generosity. At this particular point, we are continuing some other things the Holy Spirit has laid upon our heart. And so we'll give reference to that in some of the subsequent Sundays that we have here. But just in preparation for morning tithes and offerings, if you are giving out of a check, make it out to Transform Central or TC. Those of you that are still doing that, if you want an envelope for your giving. And if you want to give by e-transfer, the information is up on the screen. Or if you want to give by Interact Giving, that's in the foyer there, and they'll accommodate you. I'd like to pray We so far have raised money enough to buy 59 chickens in our chicken project. And again, what is the chicken project? This is an initiative by the Graham Association, based out of the Canadian branches out of Calgary, Alberta. And we started that goat project, the Samaritan's Purse, you know, shoebox, and then the goat project, and then we're going into chickens now. Who knows where we're going to go next, right? And so the little kids have been just, we've been teaching them on tithing and offering and alms. And they're going to probably and soon know more than you are about alms and tithes and offerings and whatnot. And so we want to activate them at a young age on how they can be generous and how they can give. And so they've been doing odds and ends jobs for dad, mom, or grandpa and grandma, or whatever. And then they come down faithfully, and they're giving $5, $10, $20, $100. It has amazed us. The project ends actually, I think it's March 31st, we said, right, Marie? So right at next Sunday, and then it'll conclude it. We're going to send it over there. And the whole idea, you guys, this money goes to that base there in Calgary, and then they distribute it and send it to some of the war-torn countries or impoverished countries, and they start businesses. So out of that, that's how they get their businesses, the eggs and whatnot. And we just are so grateful, because kids need hands-on. They need something with a hands-on. So I want to pray into that right now. So Heavenly Father, we just want to say thank you that, Lord, from the youngest to the oldest, we want to teach them, Lord. We heard one of the messages that was spoken by Mark yesterday, but it really is more blessed to give than to receive. And Lord, that's not to say there's not challenges that we go through. There's not ups and downs in our own finances. And so I pray that even that there would be a breakthrough for those that are either needing a job or needing a change in their jobs or just needing wisdom concerning their businesses or careers, Lord. I pray that you are the God of promotion, and that, Lord, that you touch their heart with wisdom today. We just want to say thank you, Heavenly Father, for your goodness, because every good gift and every perfect gift comes from above, from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. So, Lord God, your word says that as we give, it's given to us good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will people give back to us. We don't give because of that reason. We give because we live to give. We love to give. And so thank you, Lord, for blessing and prospering all your people and those that are watching live stream as well. In Jesus' name, amen. Did that information get up on the screen yet? Okay, if you can put that up on the screen, and then we'll get into the message. God bless you in your giving. The Lord. Let's open our Bibles to 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 18. What we're going to do is we're going to be doing a tag team this morning here with Pastor Mike and Vicki Powell. As we mentioned, that there's going to be some teaching that Vicki's going to be doing here on a Wednesday night, coming here in the month of April. And so we thought it would be good if we kind of, you know, introduce some of the subjects to you. So that being said, let's turn to 1 Timothy chapter 1 and in verse 18. And this was Paul the Apostle that gave acknowledgement there to his spiritual son, Timothy. And he was going through some challenges. Timothy was a pastor, as we know, and one of Paul's spiritual sons. had mentioned this toward the end of chapter 1 when he said, this charge I commit to you, son Timothy, according to the prophecies previously made concerning you, that by them you may wage the good warfare, having faith and a good conscience, which some having rejected concerning the faith have suffered shipwreck, of whom is Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I've delivered to Satan, that they may learn not to blaspheme. So, Father, we thank you, you know, today, Lord God, for just even what was mentioned in our previous pre-service prayer about just activating faith in our hearts, Lord God, faith for the impossible, because we serve you, God. You are the God of the impossible, Lord God. All things are possible to them that believe. Everybody say believe. And Lord Jesus, we're all in need of something, and we need the breakthrough. We need Holy Spirit for you to show up. Or it could be a bad day. But Lord God, we thank you that we have that confidence that it's not by the strength of men. It's not by the strength of a horse, but Lord God, it's by your strength. Because Lord, it's not by might or power, but by your Spirit. So help us, Lord God, as we just navigate, even in the season that you've given to us right now, the season of Purim, Lord God, the season in which, Lord, it's a fresh start. Spring has sprung. Lord God, the blossoms are out there, Lord. May it be the same season in our spirit. That, Lord God, that there'd be a refreshing of your ways and purposes and will in our personal lives. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. So there was something interesting there that Paul the Apostle had some knowledge that in Timothy's life, young shepherd, young pastor, and he said, I want to commit to you, Timothy. He reminded him of some of these prophecies. He said, that were previously spoken over you, that by them you'd wage a good warfare. It's interesting that prophecy, that a personal prophecy, in this case, it was personal prophecy over him. By that, he said he could wage a good warfare. Now, I want to share something with you that back in 1979, this church was taken over by another church. We bought this church, and the pastors are still alive today. They're in the mid-80s in Chilliwack. They're retired, but really not retired. They're just not as active as they used to be. But they had a vision from the Lord. They had in their heart to start a church, and that's why this was started. It was a house church, and they called it a family worship center, charismatic teaching center, world outreach center. So that was kind of the three-prong approach. The name of the church was called, I've mentioned this before, Rhema Faith Center. And way back in that day, that was in 1979, right? My wife was a part of that church back then. She was single. You know, then I came in 1980, praise God. But it was a family worship center, charismatic teaching center. We've shared a lot about family, and you really feel that dynamic of family. There's knitship. The Bible says that He sets the solitary, the lonely in families as well. Now we always know that there's much more to go by way of trying to develop a real family atmosphere in a church this size. We completely understand that. But we're really wanting to go into that direction. But one of the things that we also are sensing from the Lord is this charismatic teaching training center. Now, when we say that, we don't mean, you know, charismatic in the sense of a personality. What we're talking about, ladies and gentlemen, is a charismatic by the way of the actual, we call it the perpetuity of the gifts of the Spirit. So, you know, again, some big terms that we'll try to simplify. What it simply means here at this church, Transform Central, you know, we believe that the gifts of the Spirit are still for today. Not all churches believe that. And again, we just respect and honor the churches and the body of Christ because, you know, they're all part of the body of Christ. But we are of the persuasion that, you know, the teaching of what they call cessationism, which simply means that at the end of the era of the apostles or the disciples, that miracles are no longer for today. So in other words, you better not try to lay hands on the sick because they're not going to recover. If they do, it'll only have to be through a doctor. And we bless doctors, we bless medicine. I believe they're part of the gift of God, but that's not the supernatural in the sense of some of the miracles that you and I've seen, where doctors at the end of the day have given up on a cancer patient and said that, this is the last straw. And they go home and there's a bunch of Holy Ghost people in their church. They pray for them and God completely heals them from cancer. And you know, we've had 8 documented cases in this church where people have been healed from cancer, where they were completely, totally given up. So that's what we're talking about. And the gifts of the Spirit, they're outlined in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and 1 Corinthians chapter 14. And in that, what we believe is there still is what they call a 5-fold ministry gifts. So in Ephesians chapter 4, it talks about God gave gifts to men. The men is the men and the women, the church, the body of Christ. God gave these gifts. What did he give? He gave, number one, apostle, number two, prophet, number three, evangelist, pastor, and teacher. And he said, the reason I give these gifts, now this was God the Father that gave these gifts to the church, to the ecclesia, which is not just the local church, but the body of Christ, the universal body of Christ. He said, to equip the saints. And then it says that they would do the work of the ministry, that the whole body of Christ would be edified. So here's the idea. We just want you to really make sure you get this, is that the purpose God gave apostles and prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers is not to just look good on a Sunday or a Saturday or public worship service, not to do all the work as a professional clergy, but they would empower and equip the people in the body that you would do the same thing. In other words, that you would do what we're telling you. We may model it, but you would do it. And then as a result, the whole body of Christ would be edified. It's a body mobilization. So in other words, when Paul says to Timothy, remember those prophecies that were spoken over you? He says, by that prophecy, you can wage a good warfare. Now, some people would have a hard time with that scripture because they'll say, well, I don't believe in prophecy. I believe the only prophecy is the written word. So in other words, all the prophecy's been fulfilled. Because the word, we got the word of God, we don't need no more prophecy. See, we believe that God still speaks today. We believe that there's progression in what the Spirit of God is saying. The Bible says, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons and the daughters of God. Now, you know, at the same time, just so that we don't go into error on the other side, we don't believe that when somebody is prophesying, that it can be out of line with the Word of God. We've seen that too, where there's people that will prophesy, you know, as an example, like I'll just give a ridiculous situation. If a prophet walked in here and said, you know, this couple here in the front row, I really believe that, you know, you're not meant for one another. You're not supposed to be each other's spouse. I believe that God showed me that your spouse is supposed to be in Africa somewhere. I mean, right away we say, uh-oh, I said something's weird about this guy. Too much onions last night, right? So we believe that the Word of God says the more sure word of prophecy is what? The more sure word of prophecy is the written Word of God. So it must line up with the Word of God. And this is where many, many times people have gotten into error, the so-called prophetic movement. Now, people would say, well, we're a prophetic culture. I wouldn't disagree with that, but the Word and the Spirit must agree. It's kind of like the plane that you know starts soaring off the ground there. You've got the left wing, the right wing, you've got the Word and you've got the Spirit. And they say if you've just got the Word, no Spirit, you're gonna dry up. If you just got the Spirit, no Word, you're gonna blow up. But if you got the Word and the Spirit, you'll grow up, right? And what we wanna do is we wanna grow up. We don't wanna get, you know, go on one side of the ditch, we don't wanna go on the other side of the ditch. But that being said, we're charismatic. So charismatic, not in personality. It's okay to be charismatic in personality, but that's not what we're saying when we identify or define this. It means that we believe in the nine gifts of the Spirit as recorded by Paul the Apostle, and he was actually trying to correct some error that was there to the Corinthian church because he said, you guys come behind in no gifts. And yet he sandwiches 1 Corinthians 13 between 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and 1 Corinthians chapter 14, which is what? 1 Corinthians is the love chapter, right? So in other words, we're talking about if we could somehow marry the two, if we could marry Galatians 5:22 that talks about the fruit of the Holy Spirit. You all know what the fruit is, the love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, you know, meekness, temperance, faithfulness. And then the nine gifts of the Spirit, so which are basically in categories of three. Way back in 1980, I remember I first had this teaching when I was down in Bible college in Oklahoma. And I never knew diddly squat about this stuff. I mean, I would go to church, but they never taught this in church, and I would have been a cessationist. I thought, you know what? God doesn't speak today, or if God did speak, he would only speak through the minister. God would not speak through you because you're not qualified. You haven't been to seminary, you know, you're not ordained, and so there, God would not speak to you. If God did speak, he'd have to speak through the minister. That's kind of the way I was raised, right? So when I got born again in 1977, and I remember my friends told me, said, guess what, Ken? Like, God can speak to you. I just remember my religious mind said, no way. Like, you got to go through the guy on Sunday, you know, and if God's going to speak. It blew me out of the water when I said, you know, they call it the priesthood of the believer. meaning that for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. That God speaks. It said He spoke in the Old Testament through the prophets, and God says He speaks today through the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Holy Spirit of God. And so we were in this Bible study, and it was a house church kind of a thing. And my mentor Dennis, who just went to be with Jesus in glory, pastored for many, many years there in Lloydminster and then in Kelowna. And I remember he was a businessman, a really prosperous man. And we were going to his Bible study. And I was just 17 years old, you guys. I was just this young kid. I got saved. I just loved Jesus. And the only Bible I had was this big Bible that we would put on the coffee table, you know, for show. And that's the only Bible I had. And I packed that thing to Nelson Lumber, put it under my armpit, and that's what I would do during the coffee break, is I would read that Bible. I didn't know where to read. I remember I was in Exodus and thinking, what is this all about? I didn't have a clue what Leviticus was all about, right? Nobody told me start in John. I was just this baby Christian, right? But I was so hungry and so fired up for Jesus. And so we went to this Bible study, and they were talking about prophecy. And they said, you know, we can all prophesy. And I said, what's that? You know, prophesy? Like, you can all prophesy? I had no language, you guys, for any of this kind of stuff. You got to understand that I was just literally, you know, more ignorant than a sack of hammers when it came to religion, right? And yet I was going to be a minister in my denomination, if you can believe that. I'm glad you didn't attend my church if I would have graduated. And then here I was, and they said, well, simply it's giving an utterance, or it's giving, you know, a word from the Lord. And I said, really? You mean to say that, like, God will pay attention to me? And, you know, God will, I can hear God? Like, God, busy God, you know, whoever this God is? Like, yeah, like, God will speak a word to you or through you to the people. Amen. And I thought, well, man, I'd like to try that. You know, I was just so innocent, but so hungry for God. And they said, okay, so we activated that. So we had the Bible study. We had a little bit of worship songs. And it was a large group, probably maybe 30, 40 people in the house, big house, right? And I was a new kid on the block. I just got saved, right? You probably don't know this, Wishy, eh? This was in Lloydminster. My sister Patricia is here with me too, but she wasn't saved at that time. She was sowing wild oats. And anyway, but she got saved, as you can see. And so here we were, and I said, well, how does this happen? How does this happen that I can prophesy? And they said, well, the Spirit of the Lord is going to come upon you, and you're going to feel something in your heart. You may feel warmth, you may feel nothing, but, you know, and God's going to speak to you. And what you got to do is just quieten your heart, and the Lord's going to speak to your heart, and then you need to just release what God says. I thought, okay. You know, now I didn't know nothing about the Bible. I knew God loved the world, that He gave Jesus His Son to die on the cross for me. I knew that. And I knew Romans 10:9-10. I had confessed Christ as my Savior and as my Lord in an FGB meeting, Full Gospel Business Men's Fellowship meeting, right? So I remember I'm 17. You gotta understand, I'm 17 years old, right? You know? And I'm just, you know, I'm down there and I've got my eyes open a little bit. And they said, okay, so if anybody here has a word of prophecy, you just go ahead and you give it right now. And I'm just thinking, oh, man, this is just getting so nervous for me. And they said, well, you know, wait a minute. Why don't we do this? Why don't we just have everybody, let's take time to pray. Let's just pray out loud. Now, I never prayed out loud unless it was like before I ate, you know, a meal. You know, then I would pray. Everybody knew how to pray the same prayer, right? So it was a rote prayer. And I would just pray that prayer. But other than that, I didn't know how to pray. And other than the Our Father, but I never really prayed the Our Father, but I knew it was in the Bible. We would pray it during catechism classes, right? So they prayed around, and everybody started praying around, and I was, I don't know, number 9 or number 10, and I saw where I was coming up, and I was so nervous I went to the washroom because I didn't want, I wanted them to miss me. Went to the washroom, came back, and ready the line passed me, so I thought, praise God, I don't have to pray. But then they said, okay, now let's prophesy. Prayer, you prayed out loud, now you prophesy. And all of a sudden, I felt this thing on me. I just felt this thing on me, and I thought, oh, man, like, I was hot. I was steamy. I was like, oh, man, you know. And then I remember just looking my eyes and thinking, is everybody closing their eyes? Like, I'm closing my eyes, and I'm just thinking, you know, Lord, I need to prophesy because I feel God is telling me to say something. And I opened my eyes and I looked at Dennis's wife, Gladys, and she's looking right at me. She said, like that. Oh, I just got hotter. I just got hotter. And I thought, oh, now the limelight is on me. And I've got this word. And I got to give this word. And I just, you know, I got to pass this chicken line. And I just thought, oh, I don't know if I can do this. And I just got in such a sweat. Well, it ended up, I didn't do it. You know, I didn't do it. And I felt so bad. I felt, God, you gave me something. And even if it was just as simple as Jesus loves you, you know what I'm saying? When you first start off as a little baby, I got a word of the Lord for you. Jesus loves you. Wow. You know, but that I don't even remember what it is other than the fact that I just felt completely, completely deflated. I just felt like, no, this thing ain't working for me. You know, and again, on my agenda, my purpose was probably completely wrong. But nonetheless, Dennis takes me out the next day to Smitty's. And he says, so Ken, you know, so what happened last night? And I said, oh, man, Dennis, like, I goofed. And he said, well, what do you mean you goofed? And he I said, well, I feel I had something from the Lord, like you guys said, but I didn't do it. He says, oh, that's okay. Let's try next week. Come next week. And I said, really? See, you know, I was under so much condemnation, but he just lifted the spirit, the blanket of condemnation off of me, and it was just like, bang. Well, that's where I started. That's where I started, in this simple, simple gift of prophecy. Now, the Bible says that we would all prophesy. So I would say, really? I thought we got to wait for Mark DuPont to come. You know, some of you were at, you know, Shuttlesworth meetings this last weekend, or the Vancouver Revival Center, or the Westwood Community Church, and God bless these prophets. There was a powerful word over Pastor Mike by Mark DuPont. He's a seasoned prophet of the Lord, and there's a lot of weight in what we call the veteran or the senior prophets or prophetesses of the Lord, right? But that's not to say that we can't all prophesy. And so when we're moving into this realm of what we call the gifts of the Spirit, it's part of the DNA of Transform Central, Family Worship Center, Charismatic Teaching Training Center, and a World Outreach Center. Now, we're preaching and teaching the word. This is not extra biblical. It's not unbiblical. It's biblical. You'll find it in the scriptures. Remember, there was a man, actually it was Joel Osteen's dad, John Osteen. And when the Bible school I was a part of there, the founder there was very good friends with John Osteen. And John Osteen was a Baptist pastor of a mega church. I don't know, 5,000-10,000 members in their church down in Texas. And I remember his story where he said, you know, they would have kind of an order in their year where you had to teach on, you know, the fruit of the Spirit during this season and Easter during this season. And it came at that part of the year that he had to teach on the gifts of the Spirit. So you got to understand that not all persuasions are the same when it comes to the gifts of the Spirit. So he said, he took his notes and he said, you know, I had to do this series. And he said, this was going to be difficult for me. He said, I dreaded those Sundays that I had to preach on the so-called gifts of the Spirit. Because he said, number one, he said, I wasn't taught that in seminary. Number two is I never experienced in my life. And he's reading from his notes about the gifts of the Spirit. And as he does, and he's a smart man. He's a tremendous good shepherd. But he's reading all these notes, and then he just threw all his notes up in the air, and he says, and I don't have a clue what I'm talking about. And that's when God broke something through to him and changed his entire life, where he was introduced to a realm of being filled with the Spirit and, as a result, moving in the gifts of the Spirit. And so the Bible says, don't be ignorant, brothers and sisters, of the gifts. That's part of the reason why we're bringing Vicky on Wednesdays is that here's a mama, almost lived 8 decades, and we want her to share from the experience that she's had over the many, many, many years of what it means as far as moving into this realm of personal prophecy and the prophetic. And the thing I really like of what is being, what's going to be taught here in April, you guys, is activation. See, again, it's very difficult in a setting like this. Now, you know, last week, was it last week or 2 weeks ago that Pastor John Lowndes came in here? Was it last week? And we listened to the message. We were downstairs. And again, some prophetic words that were over Katharina and Pastor Mike. And I think he might have called out some other people here too. And again, you see that demonstrated in a public worship service. And it's great because when people receive a prophecy from the Lord, I mean, it's near and dear to your heart. Now, at the same time, you need to judge it. You need to weigh it out. And I'm telling you now that if you've had a personal word of the Lord, you know, a prophecy from the Lord, I would encourage you to find some mature spiritual fathers and mothers and bring it around them and say, would you mind listening to this? And tell me if it resonates on the inside of your heart. You know, because a lot of times what we can do is we can abuse the word. The word might be correct, but I think the biggest challenge that we often have with a personal word from the Lord, a prophecy, is timing. It's like, thus saith the Lord, Wilf and Annabelle, I see you guys in India. And all of a sudden you think, whoa, whoopee-doo. And then you sell your business, you do all that kind of stuff and say, guess what, guys, the next flight, we're going to India. And so often that people crash because they don't have the discernment on the timing. The Bible says the children of Issachar understood the times and the seasons. Sometimes if you get a prophetic word, I remember a prophet came here, actually, how many years ago was that, honey? 40 years, Bud. Bud McLean that prophesied over me, and it's now 43 years, and it still hasn't come to pass. I don't think I missed it, and I don't think he missed it. It's the timing. It's coming closer. I can tell it's coming closer, but many, many times, the prophetic words that you get, they don't come to pass the next day. But people get very discouraged, and that's why Paul the Apostle says to Timothy, hey, wage a good warfare by the prophecies that have been spoken over you. See, we've been combing through some prophetic words over Transform Central. It's one thing to get a personal word from the Lord, a prophetic word from the Lord. It's another thing when a body of believers, a church, a local church, gets a prophetic word. We've got so many prophetic words, but we need to remind ourselves, what has God been saying to us? Okay? So, Vicki, can you come up here? And so, everybody say, hi, Vicki.
Hi, Vicki.
And Pastor Mike as well. And so we just wanted to kind of share with you guys just a little bit so you get to know who Vicki Powell is. She's no stranger here. She used to be my hair salonist many years ago. There you go. That looks good. That looks really, really good. So anyway, Vicki, we really have appreciated Vicki in the house. Can you give her a hand? She's just absolutely been amazing. And you know, Vicki has got an amazing amount of knowledge. Many of you don't know, she is ordained, an ordained minister of God. She is a author. And I think more than that, though, she has a love for young people. Amen. And just wants to see young people move in where she's very gifted in getting people baptized in the Holy Spirit and moving in the gifts of the Spirit. So we're going to ask Vicki, when is kind of the first time, Vicki, that you actually encountered of what I was talking about when it comes to either the gifts of the Spirit, that kind of thing?
Well, I was saved the same as Ken in 1977. And the Lord led me to Christian Life Assembly. I was in the old building. They were building the big new one. And I guess it was about 2 years in the Lord. And there was a woman named Mary Goddard. Some of you may have heard of her. And she was teaching on the gifts. It was kind of almost a 9-month course. And so I went to that. And that's where I learned about the gifts of the Spirit and how they functioned. And it was an amplified version. Like what I'm going to teach is very minute. It's very tiny compared to what I took. But yeah, that's how I got introduced to the gifts.
Okay. And Pastor Mike, this is a question for Pastor Mike. Give us a little bit about can you remember the first time, Pastor Mike, when you were introduced to the gifts of the Spirit or anything of the Spirit? Because as you know, Pastor Mike's background would be different than Vicki. Vicki, you were raised in a religious background or no background?
No background.
No background, you guys. So no religious background, not really going to church at all? No. So here, you know, just a fresh sinner, right? You know, and then coming to Jesus, right? You know, God loves those kind, right? How about you, Pastor Mike?
Yeah, I grew up as a Baptist missionary kid. And we thought the Charismatics and the Pentecostals were all crazy and most likely going to hell. Yeah, we were pretty legalistic, you know, like we have it correct and everybody else is wrong. That was a little bit the mentality. So, they definitely were cessationists. They didn't believe in laying on hands for healing or prophecy or definitely not speaking in tongues. So I came back here and you remember Perry and Mary DeCazel, and they had a home group in their place, kind of behind where Safeway used to be. And I went over there with my brother and some others, and they were praying for people to receive tongues, to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit in tongues. And that was my first encounter with the gifts of the Spirit. Yeah.
So anybody remember those names? Is there anybody here that remember those names besides Shar and maybe Seppo? Yeah. And so in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7, could we please turn there? 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7, and we'll ask some more questions coming up right away, but because we want, again, you know, Pastor Mike and I were talking about, really would encourage as many people for the Wednesday night class. This is, I really think it's going to be life-changing for many of you. Yes. that want to be activated in knowing the pages and the scriptures on these pages that we're going to read. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 7. Again, years ago, I mean, many years ago, I remember teaching on this where it says the manifestation mm-hmm. of the Holy Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. The word manifestation means the making visible of or the spiritual illumination of. So the manifestation of the Holy Spirit, the workings of the Holy Spirit, the operations of the Holy Spirit are giving to every person so that we can all profit. So the whole purpose of what God wants to do here, you guys, for Wednesday night is so that you may profit.
Come on.
Profit what? Financially? Probably not. Not that it would not happen, could not happen, but more so in your spirit, that your spirit mm-hmm. and your heart and your mind would grow into the fullness, where Paul the Apostle said, I didn't shun to preach to you the full counsel of God, the full gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, okay? Mm. And so that's what we're talking about here as far as in the gifts of the Spirit in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And he's talking about 9, not 10, not 11, not 12, not 6, but 9 gifts of the Spirit. I'll give you an example of what happened there yesterday, Pastor Mike. Mm. And I'm not sure. I have some questions about what happened yesterday. We're still trying to think it through. But for those of you that were at this conference yesterday, there was 2 tongues mm-hmm. that were
yeah.
given.
Yeah.
Do you remember that?
Yeah.
Those of you that were there. So in other words, somebody gave an utterance. The one gentleman that gave an utterance in tongues, in fact, Jim Smart, I know him. They used to be a part of this church many, many years ago before they moved to the Burnaby area. And he's on staff, know him very well. So he gives an utterance in tongues. Now, in most churches, that's not going to go. There is no such a thing as that. But we here at Transform Center, we believe that there can be an utterance in tongues. That's actually called diverse kinds of tongues. So that's what we call one of the categories of the gifts of the Spirit. And so what we were doing, those of you that have been in that context, we're looking for an interpretation, right?
Yes.
So I'm expecting an interpretation. Rather than there being an interpretation, somebody else gave a tongue.
Yeah.
So there was actually 2 tongues that came forward. Isn't that right, Vicky?
Yes.
You were there and you were
yeah.
there, Pastor Mike.
Yeah.
So respond to that.
Well, Pastor John moved in that. Actually, the first time I've seen him move in that. So even when Pastor John here last Sunday, you know, toward the end of his message began to prophesy, kind of a word for the body, and then he went into an utterance in tongues, and you can tell the difference between an utterance in tongues and someone praying in a tongue.
Yeah.
Someone praying in a tongue sounds like someone praying in a tongue, and someone giving an utterance in tongues sounds like someone giving a message in a language we don't know. But it's got a cadence to it. Feels like there's syntax, there's stuff going on there. You're like, he's saying something and we're supposed to understand it at some point. And so he waited afterwards. He said, if anyone has an interpretation, please come forward. No one responded. I immediately felt an interpretation from the Lord, but I didn't want to just jump up there as the pastor and be like, yeah, I have an interpretation. I thought, yeah, let's give opportunity for maybe someone else in the congregation to give their sense of what they felt the Holy Spirit was saying through that. And so I waited, and then Pastor John went ahead and interpreted his own tongue, which is biblical. Mm-hmm. It's in Corinthians there where it talks about, if you're going to give an utterance in tongues, then also pray that you may be able to interpret the utterance that you have given.
That's right.
And so then he went and gave the interpretation of the tongue. And then his guests, he had Joe and Betty here, mm-hmm. friends of his from Alberta. We went out for lunch afterwards, and he also had an interpretation. And there can be more than one interpretation, and they can both be right. And you'll know it by the Spirit.
Yeah.
You'll feel it in the spirit. Because what I had was slightly different from what John had, but it was Pastor John, but it was in the same vein, right? And so for us then yesterday, when that happened, when there was two different utterance and tongues that were given like that, where nobody else is speaking, one person is speaking loudly and they're giving a message in a language none of us understand, that I was definitely waiting for the interpretation.
Yeah.
And then another guy gave an utterance, and I thought, okay, now there's going to be two interpretations, or maybe they're the same tongue, yeah, and God is just confirming it through two witnesses.
Yeah.
And there was, I guess, maybe a little bit of interpretation, but it felt small compared to the amount of the tongues that, yes, were given. And I know it doesn't always have to be word for word. Like, he went for 1 minute and you only went for 59 seconds in, yes, the interpretation. That can't be it. No.
Yeah.
So there can be some grace there. But yeah, I'm still hoping that there, I mean, it was recorded, so we can still wait on the Lord for the correct interpretation.
Yeah, yeah. So I think there again, it's just the fact that we stumble along unto perfection. The reason I said, mm-hmm, that, you guys, is the event just happened yesterday. Mm-hmm. And this morning, I don't know if you saw a text that came in, and some of the senior fathers there, we were discussing about what did you feel about the two tongues that were given and the fact that there was not an interpretation.
Yeah.
And so we're looking at that actually right now. Now, some have felt they've had the interpretation, but that's one of the, what we would call kind of the unfinished business of the conference, to say, you know, let's discuss this. Because it's very hard to facilitate a conference when you're dealing with a conference with so many different people coming from so many different places. But even in the context of a local church, the Bible says, let everything be done what? Decently and in order.
Mm-hmm.
So often we're on the order part. Let's just let it be done first, okay?
Yeah.
And then we'll bring order. You can't bring order to anything if nothing's being done, right? So let's at least let it get done, right?
Yeah.
Now, the Corinthian church had no problem because he said, you come behind and no gifts. And so they were moving in the gifts of the Spirit, but then Paul the apostle had to address some order because of some chaos that was existing on the inside, right?
Mm.
But there was a classic example, you guys, as of yesterday, and I guess last Sunday, when Pastor John showed up and gave a specific, what they call utterance in tongues.
Oh.
So we could categorize it this way. I just wrote this down, and maybe Vicky, you got different notes on that. But of the nine gifts, they call the first three are called vocal gifts or utterance gifts, right? So that is the gift of prophecy, the gift of the word of knowledge, and the gift of word of wisdom. Now understand, it's not the gift of wisdom, it's the gift of the word of wisdom. It's not the gift of knowledge, but the gift of the word of knowledge. Meaning God will just give you a supernatural knowledge about something, an event or a person. Okay, so it's just an aspect of, mm-hmm, God's omniscience. You just get, that's why they call it the gift of the word of knowledge. And then the power gifts, and there's power gifts are often known as something that they do something gifts. They're do something gifts. And that's the gift of faith. And last week, Mark talked about that, about, he said, I want there to be a real gift of faith to be released in this place, the working of miracles and the gifts of healings. It didn't say gift of healing. It actually says gifts of healings. So I'll give you an example of this. When again, an old friend of ours, Len Lindstrom, whenever he shows up here, you know where he has most success, you guys, in the gift he has as an evangelist? Anybody guess?
Healing.
Healing. What kind of healings primarily take place in Len Lindstrom's meetings? Ears. Ears. I mean, if you got problems with your ears, go to Len Lindstrom. Okay? I know other evangelists, you go there and they got tremendous anointing with growths, any kind of growths or whatever. So in other words, gifts of healings is plural.
Mm-hmm.
Now you can pray for all the sick. Evangelists and the body of believers pray for all the sick. But some evangelists specifically have a gift whereby 9 out of 10 times people get healed when they come up for a specific thing, because they've got an anointing on that. We'll get into more of that a little later. The revelation gifts, which means they reveal something. That's the gift of discerning of spirits, gift of the word of wisdom, and the gift of the word of knowledge. Now, it didn't say gift of discernment. A lot of people say, I got the gift of discernment, which quite often means you've got the gift of suspicion.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
Right? Or, you know, it's the gift of discerning of spirits. Okay, or people have, again, this is one of the errors. People come up and say, I got the gift of discerning of spirits, and all they see is bad spirits.
Yeah.
I don't believe you got the gift of discerning of spirits. I believe that you've got a troubled soul, and there's trauma in your soul, and you filter everything through that. The true gift of discerning of spirits is you see good spirits and bad spirits.
Yeah.
You see the angelic, you see the light, and you also see the darkness, right?
Amen.
I love working with people that have the gift of discerning of spirits, by the way. the people that actually see in that spirit world, especially when it comes to areas of deliverance. But Vicky, when do you first remember moving in a gift of the Spirit, or talk about the story that I talked about?
Well, while I was taking this class on the gifts, and when she came to prophecy, I turned to my sister and sister-in-law and said, that's one gift I'll never be used in because I have such a fear of public speaking. And so that was Monday night. Sunday, the following Sunday, I'm in church and I get, and I'm less like Pastor Ken, I would get hot and then I would get, and I'd be saying, God, give it to somebody else, give it to somebody else, give it to somebody else. And I got to a point where like I felt if I didn't say it, I was gonna burn up or die or something. So in Christian life, you didn't have a mic, you projected, and that's a big church. And so wow. I gave it so I wouldn't die. And and all it was not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. I was like, I gave it. And, you know, it's baby steps, right? It's baby steps. And I meant to bring the Kleenex box over, which I'm going to teach. But in prophecy, like when I would prophesy, I phoned my teacher finally. I phoned Mary, and I said, I don't think it's really God. And she said, why? I said, because I keep only getting like three sentences. And she said, she laughed. She said, Vicky, if you just relax, more will come, but you're just remembering those three, so you've got to get it out. But she said, as you relax, more will come. You give what you have, more will come. Oh, okay, Mary, I'll try. You know, it was scary. And Ted would say, I always know when you have a prophecy because I'd start moving, and I'd start pressing the pew in front of me and moving.
Yeah. So then there's the other side here now where we were involved in a movement, and interesting, Eli and Marty were with us in this, you know, with Pastor Mike and Kathleen and Shar and I, and many of you are familiar with Fresh Fire, some of you are not, but the Fresh Fire Ministries was exploding in this area, what we would call the charismatic or the gifts of the Spirit. And and then, you know, what happens, you guys, is when it doesn't go the way you want it to go, and there was a real implosion. It's interesting, you know, Eli, because Roy Fields just called me this past week, which was the main worship leader, and wanted to know how we're doing. He's down in Orlando, Florida. And it's interesting because there was also a prophetic word that Mark DuPont gave, you know, concerning that. I'll talk to you guys later about it. But Pastor Mike, what happened to us as you know, we kind of went through this season, you guys, whereby, you know, you get hurt. It's kind of like we say, once bit, twice shy, you know, and tell us a little bit, tell them a little bit about the journey. We've only got about 5 minutes, but about where did we kind of go after we saw this thing kind of imploding, seeing the supernatural, because we actually called this school here supernatural. Didn't we call it Supernatural Training School?
Yeah.
Which simply meant that we believe all of the gifts of the Spirit and all of this kind of a thing, you know, moving in that realm. And then, you know, when you see all the caca and all the egg on your face, you tend to want to just hide under a basket, right? And so we feel we've pretty well come full circle. And again, we don't want to be afraid from that because there's a ditch on one side and a ditch on the other. But what kind of happened to us because you were such a part of that?
Yeah, especially coming from a Baptist background. And we saw a lot of manifestations. And when the Holy Spirit comes on people, people can express themselves differently. During that season, that was also after 1994 and Toronto, and that had been going for a solid 10 years. Mm-hmm. There was holy laughter. There was shaking and baking. there was a lot of stuff, and it felt like in the season that we were in that everybody went, it's all the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
And then I think during the journey, we saw many people experiencing manifestations of the Holy Spirit, but it didn't seem to impact their character.
That's right.
It didn't seem to make them more full of the fruits of the Spirit. Yeah. Love, joy, patience, humility, preferring others. Yeah. And so we started getting the emergence of what we kind of termed conference junkies. People who would just come because they liked the feeling and the sparks and the energy. But in other ways, in practical ways, they weren't seeming to develop the character of Christ. Mm-hmm. And so, and then when everything, because everything went really fast and really high, and then it just went off a cliff and it crashed really. I mean, we were up at 500-600 people, and we went down under 100 people, right? And so when something like that happens, you know, you get traumatized by that, and then you start getting scared of this stuff. And so then if anybody starts moving in any of that sort of like manifestations, or what feels like a liberty that is more like license, then you start getting really scared of it, and you want to start shutting it down, which is what has happened to many denominations that started in the fire and lost the fire. Because the kingdom of God is messy. When God begins to move, you need real wisdom and real discernment to hear the Holy Spirit, because there can be a tendency to walk in the fear of man where you don't want to confront and you don't want to go, hang on, this yes, but not that, because you want everybody to like you. I mean, I like it when people like me, and I don't really like it when people don't like me, right? And so that fear of man can be a factor in there where you allow things you shouldn't allow, but fear can be a factor where you don't allow things that you should allow. Right? And so the balance that the Lord is wanting to bring the church into is to understand that there's freedom for all, but it's not a free-for-all.
Yeah, amen.
And there must be accountability. One of the things that we're learning from Church of Zion with Pastor John and the rest of those is they go, nobody's prophesying over anybody else without accountability.
That's right.
Yeah.
Like if you've got a prophetic word for someone, if your heart's really to love them, then why wouldn't you bring the family around to go, I'm going to give this, but now, according to Scripture, can the rest of you test it? Can the rest of you judge it? Can we all bear witness? Because if it really is God, it says in the mouth of two or three witnesses, let everything be established. If it really is God, then the confirmation of others going, yeah, I bear witness, yeah, is awesome. And if somehow you're missing it, aren't you thankful that there would be other people to go, yeah, I don't really, like you want to send somebody off in the wrong direction, right? And so the accountability is really important, and the fruits of the Spirit, and this is what we're so excited and proud of, that Vicky is going to come, and God has given a revelation on the 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit and the 9 fruits of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, character.
Which is, yes, we want to let everything be done, but we want it to produce life.
Amen.
Not chaos.
Yes.
And not, thank you, Lord. You know, and so I think, like, you know, a lot of Pentecostal churches and stuff over the years have started in the fire, started with all of the gifts, and because life is messy and people get hurt and things don't get done right, then they pull away from that and away from that, and after a while they're Pentecostal or even charismatic in name only. Mm-hmm. And they have what Scripture calls a form of godliness, but denying the power. Mm-hmm. And so we want the power and we want the life. Well, let me just finish with this. There's no way it won't be messy.
That's right.
The Bible says where the stall is empty, it's clean. Mm-hmm. But you get some life in the stall, there's going to be some caca. There's going to be some mess. And it's just like when you have a baby. You know, you have a beautiful, organized life, and then you have a baby, and now you're not sleeping as much, and now there's diaper smell in the house and toys all over the floor. And we have to be okay with mess. And we have to be okay as we step into this. We have to be okay with being corrected.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Pastor Lebeck, my first pastor, used to say, wildfire is better than no fire, because we can take the wildfire and teach it. We can teach from it, you know, because we're all growing and we need to grow and we need to have grace for one another. But he said, I'd rather see some wildfire than no fire at all.
Help us, Lord.
Yeah, so this is why part of the teaching training center, like, is a lot of it's changed. A lot of times we go down, we'll take 4 years in seminary or 5, 6, 7, 8 years in seminary or a Bible college, and, you know, you basically don't have a job. You go down there and you raise your funds. But, you know, Bible schools are changing. There's modules now. Like, people come and there's aspects of teaching training. Pastor Mike did a purity conference not that long ago on a Sunday night. It's the same thing. It's like it's teaching training. And that's what we want to do, is we want to equip the saints. We want to equip the saints. Amen. That's what it says. God gives the fivefold ministry gifts to equip the saints so that they do the work of the ministry, the whole body. And we're hoping that even in this whole teaching training aspect, that you're not going to have to quit your job in order to go to Bible school. I'm not saying Bible schools are not good. They have their place. You know, places like Columbia Bible College or the Summit or, you know, whatever, Bible College, Seminary, Trinity, Western University. But at the same time, there's a lot of people that don't feel called to, say, a 3-4 year, 5 year. But mm-hmm. they just said, I just would wish if our church could just equip me with some things. And this is where Vicky's coming across as a qualified minister of the Lord. And again, from experience, but a lover of God's word, and teaching on this area. And it's a Q&A, so there'll be question and answer time. The one thing about Mrs. Powell is that she's strict. You better be there on time. Yes. 7 o'clock, right?
Seven,
is that right, Vicky?
Sharp.
Yeah. And no, I'm just kidding. But yeah, it starts.
No, we're
from,
not. No, be there at 7.
Yeah.
7 till
five
what?
5 to 7.
7
nine.
Till. So 7 till 9. So if you could do 2 hours on a
well,
Wednesday
we
night.
We want to leave room, right, for the Holy Spirit. So it's not all teaching, it's for the activation part.
So give us the Wednesdays. It's in April, is
every
it?
Every Wednesday in April.
Yeah. So starting this Wednesday, I don't know if we've got a graphic up on that
next
or not.
Wednesday.
But we will have that up if we don't. And again, anybody and everybody is invited. If you're a lover of God, I wanted to actually conclude with this scripture where it says in 1 Corinthians 14, pursue love and desire spiritual gifts. This was Paul the Apostle who actually explained, wrote, moved in the gifts of the Spirit, mm-hmm. he said, but especially that you may prophesy. And so again, he's giving clarification, but we want to kind of up it a little bit as far as, amp it up, you know, concerning this area of what God's called us originally to, the DNA of this house, Family Worship Center, Charismatic Teaching Training Center, and the World Outreach Center. So you've been hearing a lot about that, but we're thinking this is becomes a probably like a glorified Bible study, but whereby it's interactive, lots of dialogue. You can ask the teacher questions. And again, hopefully that there's activation to move into a realm that maybe you've never moved into before. I think that'd be so important. I think that's the cue that we're supposed to shut down, right? Anyway, let's all stand up. Pastor Mike, do you have anything to add?
No. I'm good. That's great. So, excited.
So we're really excited. Part of this is mobilizing the body of believers. I wanted to say something here also, just because I see Josh and Megan to my right and Leah. That this also pertains to the worship. You know, Pastor Mike's been really getting downloads from the Lord about moving into a more area of the creativity and the prophetic. And you'll be hearing some of the prophetic songs of the Lord. What does that mean? What does that mean, a prophetic song of the Lord? In other words, a song that's not rehearsed, a song that you get spontaneously by the Holy Spirit. We're teaching and training some of our musicians into that arena as well. So they move into what we call this prophetic song of the Lord. It goes so high sometimes. It's absolutely so beautiful. So we want this to be enlarged into different spheres of the church. We want to teach this in our kids' church. Imagine your little Johnny, who's 7 years old, comes home one day and says, Mom, I got a word of prophecy for you. And you're going to say, where'd you learn that from, Mrs. Shar? Imagine our children beginning to prophesy. See, why not? Why not, right? I mean, they're often have a purer vessel than the adults, right? That was mentioned this morning. As adults, it's like we've grown up. And then spiritually, we need to stay as little children. So praise God. Father, we love you so much. And Lord, I don't want to wait to get to heaven to say, God, tell me you missed so much. It was all there in the Word of God. Lord, we don't want to just be cheese and cracker Christians, living on such a diet, Lord God. Yeah, we can survive, but Lord, there's buffet. There's such a large menu for us. And so we want to celebrate in everything that you have for us, Lord God, in this house. We want to see the body of believers that, Lord, was described by Paul the Apostle in Ephesians 5:27, that we would be holy, that we would be, Lord, without blemish, that we would be that bride of Christ that you're coming for, Lord Jesus. Pure and spotless. And so we just give you praise and glory and honor for that right now in Jesus' precious name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. So go get your children downstairs, you that are parents. And if you want prayer for anything, we're going to ask the prayer altar ministers to come up here right now. Whatever your need is, please come on up here for prayer. We'd love to be able to bless and pray for you. Prayer altar ministry, please come here to the front. Have an awesome, awesome Sunday.